as I said, very brief, the sustainability paradigm. I mean, as I guess everybody knows where the whole thing comes from. When the Club of Rome started addressing problems of the future, yeah, things like underfeeding or population growth, they have been still kind of positive towards when the whole thing's gonna really take place. So their forecast was quite far in the future, in 1972. But then in the 2000s, they did basically the same again. And unfortunately, what they realized is that the whole development goes much faster than they expected in the 70s. And I think if you just see what we realize on a daily basis in today, when we talk about also climate change and stuff like that, we see an enormous speed up. And I think that's also something which should be important and should we keep in the end when we discuss this whole issue of sustainability, that I wouldn't say we're running out of time, but that in the end, the whole process also speeds up to a certain extent. Yeah, the background, as you know, 1992. And why I put this is because I just wanted to show you once more how much time basically passes, right? In the 70s, people addressed this issue and said, okay, guys, we have to do something. Then 1980, the Brundtland Report came up. Then 1992, then we had the first kind of commitment to a change of our overall policies. So it's a quite slow process. And I think that's something you also have to keep in mind in today's debate on sustainability, right? That people always discuss, oh, you know, we have to change tomorrow. I mean, we never change by tomorrow. And also in the context of sustainability, nothing happened overnight, which doesn't mean that we have to accept it. But I think that's just an important thing to realize, that it's uncommon to change overnight. At the same time, why I put you this, you might be familiar with this picture, what you see on the left-hand side, with this kind of three circles overlapping, right? So the three dimensions of sustainability. So a kind of balanced development in between social, environmental, and economic field. I don't want to discuss this in detail because most I'm pretty sure that you're familiar with this. But what I want to outline is that basically, already back in the 80s, people addressed the kind of model you see on the right-hand side, which basically says, okay, this kind of balancing, right, this kind of overlapping of all those three dimensions might not be realistic. So the concept of nested dependency model basically means, okay, guys, first we need a proper environment. In a proper environment, we might have a kind of decent society. And within this society, we might even have a kind of decent, proper economy. So this means basically back in the 80s, people said that, you know, maybe we have to find a certain hierarchy. So this idea of we can balance a development in between all those three dimensions, this sounds nice, but might be quite unrealistic. And that's also something people already outlined back in the 80s. And I think that's also an important message to keep for today's discussion. And another important point from my point of view is that even in the Rio conference, people already realized we cannot wait for politicians to act. I mean, the idea those days to form this Agenda 21 is basically people have to take action themselves. They should not wait for their administration, for a political system, but instead this should be a kind of bottom-up approach. And again, this is a quite dramatic change in the way we discuss about those kind of things. I mean, we tend to stick to this idea, okay, I mean, we make changes in laws and regulations and step by step, then things will improve. But already in 1992, people said, okay, if you wait for such a process, then this might be too late. So in the end, the idea was that each and everyone takes responsibility. People should act on a local level. And by acting on a local level, then also changing the overall global development. And again, that's a very simple concept, but it was quite revolutionary those days. But honestly, I mean, when I was 20, then each city and community had an Agenda 21, and today they all disappeared again. So we see a kind of strange situation that people started acting on a local level, but unfortunately, they didn't see the results they hoped to see. And then this whole process kind of disappeared slowly again. I mean, of course, there are some examples where this is still existing, but this means that together with the sustainability concept, there have been several other concepts which we kind of neglected over the years. And okay, this might be a quite drastic formulation, but yeah, no action, talk only. I mean, the same, we everything is eco, everything is sustainable. So sustainability has become a boom word, right? And it's kind of accepted as a new development paradigm. At the same time, I mean, we simply don't act that way. And again, we can ask, is this a result of ongoing development, or is this something we just realized today? I will give you a few examples, especially from the tourism sector, in a few seconds, where we see that, again, 30 years ago, people already said, you know, we have to do it instead of just talking about it. And as I said before, I mean, basically the idea of sustainability and also the way it should be implemented is a rather radical one. And that's basically the problem. I mean, society is not willing to change. Yeah? So we find a lot of different ways to cope with the reality and therefore basically stick to the behavior we are used to avoid the consequences, right? If you think about compensation, all those kind of things. So what we did in the end, we kind of try to convert a quite radical concept in a rather unradical one to be, well, more comfortable to stay what we have. And why I now spend several minutes on discussing this, because basically the same thing what we see in tourism. I mean, tourism saw enormous boom, right? I mean, we saw enormous increase in mass tourism over the years. At the same time, we see a quite similar idea than we when we talk about general sustainable development. I mean, back in the 60s, people already discussed, this was the beginning of mass tourism, that, okay, we have to do something about it, right? So at the same time, there were not so big problems, right? Tourism was emerging, quite fast emerging, right? But okay, this wasn't really a big issue. So as I put there, coexistency. Then in the late 60s, early 70s, that's then the times, I don't know if you travel to Spain or wherever, you see those lovely skyscrapers, right? So, I mean, Benidorm in Spain has the highest skyscraper density in the world. Yeah? That's a holiday resort. People might be a little bit fascinated by those kind of things. So there it became obvious that this is tourism is something really dramatically changing the whole game. And then in the 80s, people started to work against it. So there was a big discussion about tourism impacts. What can we do? For example, increasing infrastructure, building wastewater treatment plants in the Mediterranean, things didn't exist before. So to kind of cope with the problem. But the problem was that tourism grew further and the impacts also grew further. Because basically no one addressed really the problems. I mean, this was always kind of dealing with the impacts, but it was not really addressing this issue of tourism itself. And then in the 90s, we come up with Rio, right, sustainability. And then, of course, sustainability was the big thing also in tourism. The magic question is, does this make sense? Does sustainability and tourism fit together? And that's an interesting question. As said in the introduction already, yeah, 1993 was the first time that the Journal of Sustainable Tourism was the first time published. It was amongst the most important tourism journals for a while. And I think it's also kind of eye-opening that for the last almost 10 years, the role and the impact factor of the Journal of Sustainable Tourism is constantly decreasing. So obviously sustainability is not such an issue anymore in the academic research, although it seems to be an important topic in society or also in tourism practices. So, but this means that obviously science is kind of fed up with this topic, and we will see in a minute why. So again, we look back on a quite long history also in this debate of sustainable tourism. Now we might ask why in the end we see this change. Sorry, this was the wrong button. Oops, this was not too fast. Because basically, I don't know whether you're familiar, the WTO is not the World Trade Organization, but those days was still the World Tourism Organization. Today it's even a United Nations body. And they did a quite interesting thing, because in 2004 they claimed, what I even copied here for you, sustainable tourism development guidelines and management practices are applicable to all forms of tourism in all type of destinations, including mass tourism and the various niche tourism segments. So what does this mean? This means basically that whatever negative impact tourism creates, whatever negative consequences tourism creates, it's all no problem, because everything can turn into sustainable tourism. No problem, right? It's applicable to each and every destination, to each and every situation, right? So sustainable tourism always works. From my point of view, you should be skeptical if something works in each and every case, because from my experience, that's quite rare, that something works in each and every place and also in each and every situation. But this was basically what the WTO said. And of course, I mean, the WTO is there to promote tourism development, to foster tourism development on a global scale. So what would you expect from such an institution than such a statement? And that's why I said, okay, this was the point in time when there was the official myth, yeah, of sustainable tourism born, because basically the WTO claimed that tourism can be sustainable in each and every form and each and every place. And of course, the tourism industry was quite happy about this, because this formed a totally new environment. Before, people kind of criticized tourism for all its negative impacts. Now, the situation was totally different. From this point onwards, there was tourism and there was sustainable tourism. Perfect, right? So tourism didn't have to change at all, because in future we will have sustainable tourism. Of course, this doesn't make sense, because tourism has certain impacts, has certain problems, and you just don't change them by relabeling it. But this, in the end, then formed a totally new starting situation. So if you now try to compare, let's say, or to put it next to each other, this idea of tourism reality and this kind of tourism myth, what was created, yeah, that each and every tourism can be sustainable, I think this might be quite eye-opening. Because if you compare how they expect sustainable tourism or sustainable tourism development to look like, within environmental limits, appropriate character, locally controlled using local resources, balanced with other activities, other with other economic sectors, for example, all stakeholders acting responsibly, respect for local society, culture, and politics. You know, sounds amazing, but honestly, I don't see many forms of tourism fitting into those categories. At the same time, the WTO also said, you know, for each and every country in this world, third world countries, developing countries, tourism is the perfect way to develop, right? Because basically you don't need any resources, a little bit sun, a little bit beach, and then you will have an enormous economic development. And this was promoted still basically till today. But what they didn't promote were their own guidelines. Right. So what you saw was an enormous international investment in those countries. And also what we know from tourism research, that basically the less developed a country is, the less it can profit from tourism. Yeah, because things like local sourcing don't work, then those countries start importing, yeah, then it's foreign money, foreign capital invested, which basically means those companies, they also take the money back. Right. So that's all issues which then in the end show that this is a huge contradiction to what you see on this slide. So what it should look like. So what we see basically since the 90s, we see an enormous growth. So tourism growth is even growing every year faster, right? So if you compare 2013, we had 1 billion arrivals, yeah, and just 6 years, we have 1.5 billion already. And I mean, you can travel back in time, and the time it takes to double the numbers, it's getting shorter and shorter. We see that more and more destinations on a global scale join in, also join in large numbers. Yeah, if you're talking about 1 million tourist arrivals, for example, new markets, we have new countries more or less, not just as a tourism destination, but also new markets. If you think about China, India, all those countries, all those people also joining global tourism industry as travelers. And we also saw, I mean, most of you grow up with this idea of low-cost carriers and stuff like that. So the world is shrinking, transport gets cheaper and cheaper. And of course, all those aspects, they support everything but not a sustainable development, right? I mean, if the low-cost carrier costs 30 euros and the train trip 200, then I think it's kind of logic what decision people choose. At the same time, if you go to the EasyJet website and the Inspire Me button tells you for 15 euros you can fly to a place you've never been, you didn't even know that it exists, and then you say, okay, just check it out. So this is what I tried to put there, sustainable development versus market economy, right? And also, of course, the more tourism grows in certain regions, this means the higher the dependency on tourism. And tourism is a quite complex thing. I mean, tourism is quite, yeah, complicated to handle. In terms of, is there a conflict in the region? Is there a kind of natural hazard or so? Tourism has a lot of seasonality. So it's not really a good economic sector to make a lot of money with on a constant base. There are much better economic sectors which are much easier to handle. And also what we see is that basically we promote a more sustainable behavior, and we also hope for more sustainable tourists. But honestly, in research, it's quite hard to identify those guys, right? So we are still looking for the responsible tourists and really showing this highly responsible tourist behavior, which then might support a more sustainable tourism development. What we see is that all the new markets joining in are typical large-scale mass tourists. So in the end, we see some of the old established markets in Central Europe, which change to a certain extent. But if you think about the enormous growth rate in new emerging markets, they don't really follow this idea of a responsible tourism approach. So what do we see? We see there in the back, you see Benidorm. That's what I mentioned before, right? So the lovely skyscrapers, you see the beaches. You even see hiking tourism also might not be very sustainable. That's from the Lake District in England, right? So if you have hundreds of people going hiking, yeah, or wandering through the fields, then this also leads to erosion. And we live a kind of myth, right? So this idea of individual travel, individual tourism experiences, stuff like that. In the end, most of those products are basically mass tourism products today. So how can we explain this? Or what is the basically misunderstanding when we talk about sustainable tourism? And I said that in the beginning already, yeah, in 2000, Radcliffe already puts in an article, the power of the concept of sustainability lies in the discourse surrounding it rather than in any shared substantive or heuristic value it may have. So basically this means it's good to talk about it, but it's not a concept which can be really implemented. So it makes sense to create awareness on the topic. It might also be important to address it. It might also be an interesting goal, an aim to work towards this direction. But I mean, it doesn't really answer any question. So what should be developed against what measures? Who is responsible? So tourism is a global industry, So, who is responsible to make tourism more sustainable? The customers, the destination where tourism takes place, the tour operators. You might now say each and everyone, yes, but I think from your own experience, you know, if each and everyone is responsible, then in the end, no one is responsible, right? And the question is, sustainable for whom, right? So do we want to have a sustainable industry? So should TUI earn most of the money, or do we want to have a sustainable destination? So is it all about the regions to save them? So you see a lot of interests and conflicting interests, and those issues have never really been addressed because it's so easy to say, okay, we are now sustainable, each and everyone out, end of the story. Yeah. So might be hard. At the same time, thinking about also all your eco labels and green labels, that's something you also used to. And in many cases, of course, you can market a sustainable tourism product better than a not sustainable one, right? So you can say, okay, you can feel better. We are green and ecological and basically for no extra money. Right? Because that's also what we know from research. There is no really willingness to pay extra price for environmental friendliness or sustainability. So as long as the same price, it's fine. So this means basically in most of the cases, it's a kind of marketing tool. Because implementing all those measures, of course, is not for free and will have consequences. Will have consequences, for example, in terms of limiting access. And of course, that's what no one wants, right? You don't want to be told that you're not allowed to go there because there is already another million tourists, right? So this means this would create conflicts, and that's not what you want. At the same time, and that's what I said in the beginning when we talked about this, a myth is born. I mean, just by outlining there is something like sustainable tourism, if you think about a second, this doesn't make sense at all. I mean, tourism always about traveling, tourism is always about creation of CO2 emissions and so on and so on and so on, right? So just creating this illusion that tourism can be sustainable saves basically the ass of the industry, right? Because now they claim, okay, you know, all the negative impacts you see, that's tourism. But in future, we will have sustainable tourism and everything's going to be fine. And by doing so, in the end, they divert the attention from the problems. I mean, basically, the tourism development we see has not changed at all, right? I mean, it's still like in the 70s. Maybe your large-scale skyscrapers are now more colorfully painted, but the business model is exactly the same. But through promoting sustainable tourism, they are able to keep their traditional business model of typical stereotype of mass tourism. Because we accepted that, of course, there is a negative form of tourism, but there is also the good form of tourism. And a last point, which I think is also important in today's times, of course, it's a kind of Western-centric approach. So basically means we telling other countries, yeah, especially developing countries, you know, guys, you should not develop because you should be nice and quiet and, of course, ecological, because we want to have nice places to visit, right? I mean, some people talk about even kind of neo-colonialism or eco-colonialism when addressing those issues. And of course, that's now a quite extreme thing. But I mean, if you think about it, so, you know, there's always this kind of message what tourism industry conveys, right? For example, if you travel to the Mediterranean, you travel to Greece, right? And you got the old lady sitting on the donkey and riding through the village, right? That's what you then take a picture and send it home or send, make a picture postcard. But that's not what Greece looks like, right? I mean, Greece is a modern country. But they should stay as they are. They should stay like in the 19th century to fulfill our stereotypes and to be the perfect holiday destination. Worst case, if you then talk about even less developed countries somewhere else in the world. So we want places to visit. We want places to look like as we expect them to be. And they should not develop. They should be just the stage for our holiday experience. As I said, drastic, but I think at least worth thinking about it. So now, after talking about all those kinds of things, so what is now the truth of tourism? So what is tourism all about? I mean, tourism is a global activity, right? So tourism is growing, tourism is global, and tourism basically results in over-exploitation of resources. I mean, if you have a nice beach and you have people visiting, then no one comes up with the idea, okay, we limit now the numbers. No, you build just a few more hotels, then you build an airport, then you build a motorway and so on, because if the business model is working, then growth is the best solution. In order to survive and grow, yeah, in the end, tourism absorbs all resources existing in a certain place. That's also something what you realize in MV. I mean, for example, when we discussed whether we should have more wind energy plants or whatever out there on this sea, on the ocean, not even visible from the coastline, tourism industry was the first one to complain, you ruin the whole country, you ruin the tourism industry if you build those offshore parks. As I said, not visible from the coastline. But so this means tourism industry is very strong in kind of trying to stop other industries to grow where they might see a certain threat, right? Tourism is also hard to regulate because it's not just one sector. I mean, tourism includes a lot of sectors, accommodation, service providers, transport providers, and so on and so on, right? So in the end, it's hard to control, it's hard to regulate. And also what we said before, I mean, we don't really see our sustainable tourists out there in a large scale. So I just get this citation from Richard Sharpley. I just loved it. Tourists are consumers, not anthropologists. So basically means, okay, they are not all good guys, right? Basically, they are on holiday. They give a shit about all the good ideas you have. They want to enjoy themselves. And that's it, right? They don't want to care about how sustainable they are or how sustainable the industry is. Most tourists seek relaxation, fun, escape, and entertainment. They don't wish to work at being a tourist, right? So, and that's, again, from research we know, people being very, very sustainable back home, separating waste, recycling, all those kind of things. As soon as they go on holiday, they behave in a totally different way. Because holiday leisure time is about having fun. It's not about following regulations. It's not about being sustainable. It's fun, right? And there, I think we also made some mistakes because we always told people sustainability is a must and you have to do this. So people have a quite negative connotation with this. So holiday is something positive. Sustainability is something, something we have to do. And this doesn't fit together. And this makes it quite hard to implement. So what in detail? So if you think about how should we manage, or I mean, what basically we teach in our tourism programs, for example, also in Stralsund, what solutions can we offer, or what might be important? I mean, an issue is of course that it makes sense to take a look at different scales, right? So tourism impacts are quite different on different scales. So tourism might create a huge economic impact, but then the question is, for the whole country? No, for a very limited area, for example. What about the area around it and so on? So you need a quite small scale approach to really evaluate what's going on. At the same time, instead of focusing on the benefits of tour operators and tourism businesses, there might also be the question, should we maybe prefer to save the regions, the destinations from those tourism impacts? That's also an important question. Is something like limitation of tourism a way to go? Or can we kind of make sure that there is still a positive economic impact, but maybe a less environmental one or a less social one? Yeah? And what we need is, in the end, we need a tourism industry adopting to the framework conditions, right? So, I mean, it doesn't make sense to say we ban tourism. I mean, that's what no one wants. But what we need is a kind of balance. So increasing short trips, right? So the 2-day flight to Barcelona and back, that doesn't make sense. So the shorter the holiday is, the longer the trip is. That's all things which don't make sense at all. And 20 years ago, this was also simply not possible. Right. So we have to think about some forms of tourism, certain tourism products, which simply make the whole industry much less sustainable than the sector could be. And of course, it's an issue of planning and control. The point is that in the end, it's an industry. Those guys, they want to make money, totally fine, as any other industry as well. So this means if we want to force them to be more sustainable, more environmental friendly and stuff, we have to force them. That's costs for them, so they are not keen on it. And it's not enough to make regulations, but of course you also have to control them. And if you don't do this, no industry in this world will give a shit about any regulation. So as stated before, I mean, this all sounds quite negative and I don't want to stop anyone of being a tourist, but it's just important to think about those aspects. Of course, we can also take the other side. I mean, tourism is a good thing. I mean, of course, traveling to countries, experience places, getting to know new people, right? And tourism is big business. Right. So they're a vital interest. I mean, some countries completely depend on tourism, right? Which again makes it complicated to address issues or to regulate. But tourism is in most of the cases seen as an economic activity, but it has enormous environmental impact. It has enormous social impacts, but that's something people don't care that much. I mean, basically it's a business activity and this means we are coming back to our hierarchy, right? You remember, right, in the beginning, our nested model, right? So as long as we always concentrate on economic impacts, then automatically we will neglect the others. And that's, of course, a big problem in tourism. I mean, you travel to places because they are nice, you want to enjoy them. At the same time, tourism in many cases destroys what you are looking for by going there, basically. Yeah? So this means we need a much higher focus on environmental sustainability, maybe also social sustainability, because I guess you also have experience if you travel to a country and you don't feel welcome anymore, then it also doesn't make sense. Yeah, I mean, honestly, when I ask my tourism students, they tell me, you know, I give a shit if they don't welcome me. I want to go there and I go there. But at the same time, I think it's just better framework conditions if you don't feel hated on a daily basis if you're visiting a country. And so we have all those aspects. And to put it in a nutshell, coming back to Richard Sharpley, I mentioned him before already. This suggests that the principles of sustainable development cannot be transposed onto tourism as a specific economic social activity. In other words, true sustainable tourism development is unachievable. And again, that's 2000, right? So that's more than 20 years ago. So already in 1995, we had a quite similar statement from Hunter. So basically, we know sustainable tourism, development, at least from an academic point of view, we know that this is not possible. This doesn't make sense at all. But it's promoted for more than 30 years. Everybody thinks about it. Everybody believes in it. And yeah, also, if I put such a presentation for my students in our program, whether it's the bachelor or the master program, then I get an evaluation outlining that, you know, we don't want to hear this because we want to work in the industry and we want to be happy and we don't want you to destroy our positive picture of the industry. So that's what I'm confronted with on a regular basis. But okay, sometimes it makes sense to see the other side as well. So now, as I said, I want to address to you. So, I mean, we have lots of different ways. I mean, either you can put something in the chat or you just switch on your microphones, because I'm also interested in your perspective on this thing. As I said, it was kind of dramatic, it was kind of negative, and each and everyone has its own experience about tourism. So what is your own experience while being a tourist on sustainability and tourism? Have you ever realized that this is an important thing, or I don't know, talking to friends, do they choose destinations based on their sustainability, or what is yeah, your perception of this issue? I also put you, have you ever reflected on tourism phenomenon in the way presented in this presentation? So basically, well, have you ever thought in such a negative way about the good thing tourism? So was this kind of provocative to you, or do you say, okay, no, I mean, the guy just said what I always thought about tourism, would also be interesting for me. Do you think tourism has to be limited, right? So do we have to address this issue? Do we say, okay, we have to limit the amount of people traveling, maybe we have to limit access to certain places, to certain destinations, to save them, yeah? But if you think that way, then you also have to keep in mind, what about the consequences? So who's allowed to visit? Yeah, so maybe you are also not allowed to visit any longer, right? Or maybe this comes together with additional costs. And last question, what could be the way forward from your point of view, right? I mean, you all want to travel in the future, I guess. So now you've basically four questions to choose from. And yeah, I'm pretty much looking forward to your ideas now.
Mr. Gronau, there's yep. already one question in the question field on the right side.
Just a thing.
Can you see it?
Yeah, I just have to change the setup.
Okay.
Ah, yeah. Okay. No. Can you give an example as to how some specific tourist destinations claim that it's sustainable, whereas you think it's not, and why not? Oh, yeah. Maybe we start with this. I mean, there are several destinations out there. I mean, Costa Rica has decided that they even climate positive. Norway has done similar things. So by claiming that they have forest, they compensate their CO2 emissions, for example. And so there are many destinations who have been quite creative, basically, and in kind of futile. I mean, I guess we all agree Norway has not planted the forest and Costa Rica has not planted the rainforest to compensate CO2 emissions. I mean, it was always there. So therefore, of course, it's low-hanging fruits, right, to claim, okay, we have a rainforest or we have forests which then basically compensate our CO2 emissions. And that's a good example from my point of view when we talk about greenwashing, for example. Okay, then, for example, giving tourists a free public transport pass or cooperating with local food distributors using energy. I mean, of course, there is a long list of examples, and I completely agree. Switzerland, for example, is quite famous for creating agricultural cooperatives, especially to support the tourism industry in sourcing, because it always sounds quite easy to do local sourcing, but in the end, it's rather complicated because, a hotelier is quite keen to get a certain amount of, I don't know, carrots, potatoes, or whatever on a regular base. And of course, you cannot provide in large scales all the things, everything at the same time. If it's just one producer, if it's one producer and he can, then he's again too big. So it's also not very sustainable anymore. And Switzerland, for example, introduced large scale cooperatives. So this basically means several small producers joining in and then also supporting tourism industry, supplying them. So there are good examples out there. Some countries have gone further than others. Also, you see in some Latin American countries that, for example, hotels, then they even buy in plantations where they then even produce some fruits or vegetables for their own consumption themselves. So, I mean, it's not the case that they are not good practices or best practices. The problem is the scale, right? So I can name you a lot of positive examples. The problem is always the scale. I mean, it doesn't help if it's 5 or 10 of them and the other 50 million don't do it, right? So the question is, how can we scale up those kind of things? I think renewable energies, that's a similar thing. I mean, for example, when we go on field trips, for example, in Cyprus, many have some kind of solar systems, panels and stuff like that. But again, it's a matter of scale. I mean, basically to cover the need of a 400-bed hotel, you need quite a lot of solar panels, right? So, and then we quite often also talk about window dressing again. If you put 5 solar panels on the roof and then you produce 5% of the energy yourself, of course, that's 5% you produce. But on the other hand, of course, this doesn't really solve the issue. Tourism can be different in every way. It can be good. You go to a place, you want peace, quiet. Okay. Yeah, that's another good question. I mean, basically, we talk about, of course, a highly diversified tourism industry, right? So this means basically that's why I said before, when we talk about scale, right? So this means you really have to have a decent evaluation for a specific region, for a specific area. It's not so easy to always kind of generalize. On the other hand, what we see is that the business model of tourism industry, so for example, the large operators, I mean, that's a pure quantitative business model, which basically means, I mean, TUI, they earn quite a little money basically per booking. So basically their interest is to send as many people as possible to create their profits, right? So basically the business model is a pure quantitative business model. And as tour operators are major drivers of tourism industry and tourism development, I mean, if you think about, I don't know, Dominican Republic, Gabon in Africa, where basically one tour operator, they contacted the government, said, guys, build an airport and we build a few hotels. And in 25 years, when the hotels are run down, we close the place and we go to the next. So this means we are back with this this conflict of large scale and small scale, and of course there are also alternative models. But you know what the problem is? Basically, what is a quiet place for you today might not be a quiet place tomorrow anymore, because that's also something we experience. Because as soon as people realize, oh, you can make money with tourism, then investment starts. Right. So, and then as soon as this development really takes off, then it's really challenging to stop such a development. So what started off as a quite cozy, small place then can easily turn into a large mass tourism destination simply based on the financial and economic interests of people involved. Okay, so what else do we have? I think the pandemic showed that there are ways to stop or at least slow down. That's an interesting topic. Because I'm also a member of the German Tourism Research Association, and amongst the colleagues, we quite often discussed how will the pandemic more or less influence future tourism development. And basically, you see two parties. The ones, they say, okay, this might be a turning point, people might change, and everything will be more sustainable after. And the other half basically says, no, nothing's gonna change. Personally, I pretty much belong to the second group, because, I mean, if you just analyze the interest of people, I mean, people say, okay, you know, they don't travel domestically now because they want to. They travel domestically in the area because they feel more safe, right? It's easier to organize, all those kind of things. There are a lot of travel restrictions, but from my point of view, their basic interest is to go on with business as usual as soon as they are able again. So as I said, this is my private opinion, right? And also, you see, how fast the for example the airlines, I mean, they are basically back with almost 70% of their capacities again. So EasyJet launched basically 70% of their flights till the rest of the year again. So this means you see how fast this is developing again, and this only works because obviously there is still a lot of interest in going back to as it was before. Yeah, of course, I cannot deny that maybe you now make a domestic holiday and then you enjoy it and say, okay, maybe next time we don't have to fly, I don't know, to Spain, we can also stay in the region. But I question whether this will have a huge effect overall. But as I said, this is an opinion. We don't know. We still have to wait and evaluate. But okay, what else do we have? Yeah, that's also a good question. Isn't tourism basically a luxury good? Yeah, I agree. I mean, the interesting thing is that Cohen always says tourism is basically, or travel is, a kind of democratized travel. So basically he means that in our societies, we strongly believe that traveling, going on holiday is so normal and it's a God-given thing. At the same time, that's a rather new thing. I mean, if you go back to the 50s, tourism wasn't normal and long distance traveling wasn't normal, right? But our perception is that it's totally normal to fly to Australia and I don't know what. And this changed basically within one generation. I mean, I'm 46 now. I traveled with my parents, I don't know, to former Yugoslavia by car for 3 days, right? And if I compare with my students in today's times, with 17, they've been 5 times to Australia, 3 times to South Africa, and I don't know where. And they wouldn't even question this. So, of course, I agree it's something luxurious, but I would say the vast amount of people, the majority in the society, they wouldn't accept this as being something luxurious anymore. They think it's normal and it's a God-given right for each and everyone to travel. And I think that's an issue also related to the low-costers, right? So this idea of course we have to be able to fly for 30 euros, I don't know, to Turkey. I mean, 15 years ago, this wasn't simply possible. Today it's normal. And, you know, it's always hard to get back to something people already get used to. So if you now, for example, I mean, we have had long discussions about increasing the prices of low cost and stuff like that, but basically this doesn't work because you don't find a majority within the society to agree on this, right? So politicians are simply scared to put proper pricing strategies to kind of stop this process, because basically people want to and they think, no, it's not something luxurious, that's something we just have the right to do. Okay, so what else do we have? Kurtaxe. Oh, that's also a complicated issue. So sustainable tourism is just a bit of wishful thinking. Is some kind of emission trading or even tourism tax similar to the Kurtaxe, but for funding projects, an option to offset the negative impacts? Yes and no. I mean, maybe we can start with this idea of offsetting. It's now a quite fundamental question. And this brings us back to what I said in the beginning. I mean, basically, sustainability is a radical concept. So this means we should change, and we should change ourselves, and we should take responsibility. Now, that's, of course, something what people usually are not so keen on. And this whole compensation issue is a good example. So basically, if you say, okay, I still want to fly to Mallorca or, I don't know, to the Maldives 3 times a year, and you feel guilty. And that's something what I realized with our students, that most of our students say, okay, basically, I feel guilty to do so, but I want to, dot, end of the story. So now, but, you know, if I compensate my flight, then I don't feel guilty and I can still do it. And, you know, it's basically not such a big amount of money, and therefore, yeah. So basically, this idea of we compensate is, of course, on the one hand, something good. It's better than doing nothing. But on the other hand, it gives people the chance to go on with business as usual. We just pay 5 euros on top. and we don't feel guilty anymore, and nothing has to change. So I think that's the important aspect to keep in mind when we're talking about those kind of things. Similar when we talk about things like Kurtaxis or a kind of tourism tax. I mean, many countries introduce this to kind of compensate the negative consequences of tourism. But then, of course, it's always a hard thing to evaluate what negative impacts are generated by tourism or by tourists, what are effects which happened anyway, which can then, for example, be compensated or not compensated. At the same time, if you have a tourism tax, then there's always this idea, okay, this has to support tourism industry. So I don't know, then this should be used to increase the quality or the attractivity of a destination, which then again leads to even more tourists. So usually the income of a tourism tax is rarely used to really counter tourism development, but it's more used to further speed up tourism development, to introduce new services, to introduce new infrastructure, which might decrease certain impacts. Because if you have more capacity, if you have better transport infrastructure, then maybe you have lack or you have less traffic jams. But in the end, it's not really this idea to reduce negative impacts, but to make tourism more attractive. That's what it's in many cases used for. Okay, what else? Sharing economy. Sharing economy, also a complicated topic. I mean, the main question is, for example, when we talk about social impacts of tourism, we know that locals are kind of annoyed by tourism, not due to the number of tourists and not due to how frequently they travel and stuff like that, but if they don't have the chance to have their own kind of privacy any longer. So this means as tourists start invading into private spaces. So this means if we have a destination where we have a high concentration of tourists in certain areas, then usually locals don't have such a big problem because they say, okay, we still have some bits and pieces where we can have our own stuff. So we just avoid places where there are a lot of tourists and stuff like that. But what is the problem now with Airbnb and all those kind of things? That now tourists show up in places where they didn't show up in the past, right? So if then tourists just enter private homes, private places, so they appear no longer in the classic tourist areas, in the hotels, apartment complexes, but they spread out. And that's, for example, a big issue what we see in urban tourism. That in the end, in some areas now you have tourists where you never had them. And a good example from our own research is maybe a very, very strong stereotype, but we asked locals in Munich about how they perceive this over-tourism issue. And they said, you know, as long as we have our small private beer garden in our area where we don't see any tourists, they can crowd the whole city center, they can crowd all the major beer gardens, but as long as we have our small ones. But what they said, okay, now, thanks to Airbnb and all those kind of things, and also thanks to the new traveler, which wants to have authenticity, which really want to experience destinations, then they start invading in those places. And then people really get annoyed because they say, okay, now we don't have any privacy left. So this means it's a very, very complex topic, right? Because we're talking about how do people perceive certain things. We talk about the use of infrastructure and so on and so on. So I think I got now at least basically most of it, or did I miss something out? And I'm pretty much good in time, or so I'm supposed to end in 2 minutes.
Yeah, thank you very much. Are there more questions? Or do you want to add something?
Okay.
Somebody's still typing.
Okay. Okay, then just from my point of view, I'd like to thank you for attending. Yeah. As I said, it was a little bit provocative, but I think it's always good to create food for thoughts. And I think everybody should have his own idea, but it's always important to see different perspectives on the whole issue. And my aim as a professor is always, I want that you have your own opinion, but at least based on several different perspectives, so you can choose. And then you decide what should be your point. And I think that's the most important thing. So therefore, thanks for attending such an event. Thanks for listening to me. And also thanks for the positive feedback. I wish you all the best. I hope you enjoyed everything so far. And yeah, maybe I see one or the other, maybe one day in the amphitheater in Stralsund. All the best. Thanks. Bye.
Thank you too. Bye.